Hello, good evening, and welcome to this edition of Good Evening Ghana. Yesterday, President Mahama commissioned the first gas project, the Atuabo Gas Project, and he said something. He said this was going to be a game changer for the petroleum sector and also for the general economy of Ghana. Tonight, we'll find out from the Honorable Minister of Petroleum why we should believe President Mahama when he says that this is a game changer. Yesterday, there was pomp, circumstance, and pageantry at Atuabo when all and sundry of the government of the NDC arrived and descended on the Western region to inaugurate this all-important project. Tonight, we have many questions about the project, not least of them, why was the project relocated? You remember that matter. We're going to also talk about the gas itself. How is it going to change? We're also going to get a historical understanding of where this has come from, because Minister Kofi Buah, the Honorable Member of Parliament for Elembele, has been with this process from inception nearly 7 years ago up until now. We are happy to have had one person who has had a longevity with this process, right from the time that the Ghana Gas Tax Force was set up. Minister Buah will be letting us into all of those details. And then what happened to the reintegration of Ghana Gas and the GMPC? That's also part of the story, and he'll be telling us all of that tonight, so we can understand whether or not it's truly a game changer. After the break, we'll be talking to the Honorable Minister for Petroleum. He has a great story to tell, and we'll hear that. After the break, we'll be right back on the Atuabo Gas commissioning. Thank you very much for your time, and the Honorable Minister has joined me in the studio. He is going to give meat to what President Mahama said yesterday. He said it's a game changer. Good evening, sir. I have to say congratulations to you.
It is good to be here.
You've had a tough week, and I think that you hosted everyone in Atuabo excellently. That's what we are hearing, including the media.
Well, yes, of course. Been a very wonderful week, especially for the hardworking engineers and the workers on the ground.
Is this project on schedule or is it behind schedule?
Well, I think that the project, quite frankly, international standards, was within schedule. But obviously, this is a day that we cannot forget. And I think that is what we should celebrate and talk about, and all what it took for this day to come.
People were saying yesterday that this is a vision of Professor Mills, started with Mills and a Ghana Gas Tax Force. But we're happy that at least you are one of the people who have been with the process from the beginning up until now. So tell us about the project.
Indeed. When we talk about inaugurating this huge project, we pay tribute to the foresight of His Excellency, the late Professor Mills. You know, when we were all excited about oil, it was focused on gas and the importance of gas going forward for our future. A tax force was set up indeed, and their key recommendations were that it is critical that we add value to gas and make sure that the thermal plants of this country, which will critically be using gas, will be benefit from indigenous gas. And that's what led to the establishment of Ghana Gas. That's what led to this project. And so we pay tribute, and that is why the president rightly did by letting us all rise for a minute of silence yesterday
to recognize their vision.
That is
so correct. Where does the gas come from? I mean, if you're addressing a 21-year-old student, where does the gas come from? We know oil comes from under the ground.
It is amazing. This is a very huge project. If you think about it, we already know that the FPSO Kwame Nkrumah was producing oil. And for a long time, we were injecting the gas. And it was very seriously hampering oil production. We needed to make sure we bring the gas.
Is the gas a byproduct of the oil?
That is the gas. This is associated gas, so it comes with the oil.
So anytime we get oil, we get gas.
But let me give you the full insight of the project. And this is a project that is coming from 58 kilometers offshore, all the way to the shore, and quite frankly, to a gas processing plant that is as complex as you can imagine. It comes basically wet with about four different projects. It is separated. You have the lean gas, you have the condensates, the pentanes, and the LPGs. What is critical for us is the lean gas that is sent straight 110 kilometers, passing through about six districts, Elembele, Evaluejura, Ahanta West, Mpoho, Wasa, Sekendita, Kwadi, all the way to Abuazi. 60 communities, rivers, bridges.
What is the what is the gas going through?
It's going through a pipeline.
Where is the pipe? Is it under earth?
Yes, a 20-inch pipeline that has been laid 111 kilometers all the way to Abuazi. And so when we talk about this project, you have to imagine the magnitude of it. And in the course of the construction of this project, you have to imagine the type of communities we had to deal with, the stakeholders that had to come in, local authorities, and quite frankly, it was a huge project. But indeed, it took a lot of hard work. And we pay tribute to all those who contributed for this project that, quite frankly, is now producing on average 100 million scf a day to power our thermal plants in Abuazi.
That's interesting. So all of this construction was done. Who paid for it?
Well, as you, if you recall, there was a huge debate about the need for us to basically invest in a project that will really address one critical constraint to our future, to the creation of jobs, that is electricity. And President Mel started, quite frankly, let me say that this, it was obvious that when we discovered oil and it was associated gas, it became clear that the gas had to be developed. So to be clear, this whole concept started with a previous government, President Kufuor, but it never took off. We came and we took the steps, led by His Excellency President Mills, to go for the CDB loan, $1 billion. If you remember Parliament, there was a debate. We finally got it approved, and that's how this project started. And that led to a project that I have described. And what that really, really means...
Well, on your screens now, viewers, as Minister is speaking, is the pictures of yesterday's event.
The whole Western Region House of Chiefs were there yesterday with chiefs. And if you can imagine, almost six districts, 60 communities, each one, land compensation issues, dealing with all of them. It was an amazing day. And it was an amazing day because for these communities, it was also a life-changing project. And I will tell you why it is a life-changing project.
Tell us.
This is a project that, quite frankly, has brought gas. And you know what that means? That means that for the first time, power plants that will be in Tema are now scrambling to be on this location. They are not only going to be in Abuazi. As I speak, we have companies like Agrico, Wuta, Quantum, so many of these companies coming closer to the gas. But that is not that. You see hotels springing up, jobs being created. Yesterday, we were at a construction site where young people, over 200, working to build one magnificent hotel, where one, the president visited a new hotel that has just been opened. Standard Bank, Eco Bank, these are banks that we never imagined will come to that area.
That's interesting.
So
let's take it step by step. We are creating
a new growth pole.
Let's talk about the thermal plants, because I want people to understand what you're saying. You said thermal plants are going to be located in that area. What is a thermal plant?
Well, remember that when we started as a country, all we knew was Akosombo.
We were generating electricity
with water. Well, obviously, in the next 10 years, think about it. This is why the leadership being provided by President Mahama in this gas industry is critical. In the next 10 years, 80% of the power we use in Ghana will be Tema. That is using not water, but using machines to basically generate power, and the key ingredient to powering this is gas.
Okay, so thermal is like a generator.
Yes,
that generates energy.
That is correct.
But it uses gas.
It uses gas. And so the key ingredient is gas. But for the longest of time, our constraint was that we had to go and buy expensive light crude oil, which is basically two times the cost of gas, to power those thermal plants. And think about this. One cargo of that light crude oil is about $86 million. And it was very huge. We tried. We thought about it as a country. We were convinced by the World Bank and others that, no worry, we have a lot of gas in Nigeria. Invest your money in it. And Ghana led the effort into a $1 billion pipeline coming all the way from Nigeria.
The West Africa gas pipeline.
Well,
is that what you're talking about?
That's correct. But you know the history more than I do.
Yeah.
That gas, quite frankly, I describe it, never came. Because there was so much constraint, we couldn't rely on it. We were dreaming of the day that we could have our own gas, indigenous gas. And we are on a forward march with this construction, with the layout of other projects that are coming. And let me tell you why I'm so excited about the future of this country. We have reserves of about 5 trillion cubic feet of gas.
Oh, say that again.
Modest. 5 trillion cubic feet of gas. Think about this. Mm-hmm. This gas from Jubilee is 120 million. At the end of this month, I'm blessed to join the First Lady to Singapore to commission a second project called TEN. That FPSO is named, will be named after His Excellency President J.E. Mills. Mm-hmm. It is sailing to Ghana to develop our second major production.
Oil production. So this FPSO is what? It's a ship?
It's basically a vessel. A ship that has been converted to basically produce oil and gas. In this very one, it is going to produce about 60,000 barrels of oil and about 60 million cubic feet. Modest.
Of gas.
But we'll move to another major development, which is purely NEN-associated gas. That is the biggest project that the whole West Africa has seen. A project that is over $6 billion. And guess where it's happening? Ghana, and in the same enclave. And guess what is exciting? We have worked so hard, led by His Excellency President Mahama. It has never happened in Africa in the longest time for a NEN-associated gas project of this magnitude to get world market institutions, including the World Bank, to support it, to make it happen. It is happening, and that is the game changer. It is going to produce about 180 million cubic feet of gas, transforming the way we produce electricity for the future. Mm-hmm. We don't stop there. Full-field development is also coming with more gas. And so if you look at the projections we've made and the effort we are doing, we are adding more gas to our thermal plants. So as the power plants come, and they are going to be thermal going forward, because we already know that our water bodies are not enough.
Thermal means energy by gas.
Mm-hmm. Thermal means power plants, as you described, the small generators are the small generators. Mm-hmm. Bigger plants using gas.
To produce energy, that electricity for us.
That is the exciting part. Mm-hmm. But what is also exciting is that what that means is that we are really taking the lead in the sub-region. Mm-hmm. To protect our future, our energy security, but we are going to be leaders in the sub-region again. If you remember, Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah started Akosombo, and that is why when you go to Benin today, they call electricity Akosombo.
Oh, I see. That's a new idea.
Because we have been supplying Togo Benin electricity since they are independent. Mm. We are moving strongly to make sure we strategically, with the leadership being provided by His Excellency President Mahama, to make sure that we are strategically the leaders of power generation in the sub-region. And why that is important is that if you think about the transmission lines being connected to the whole sub-region, going all the way to Nigeria, and Nigeria's deficit in power is over 40,000 megawatts. And we think that we are making a lot of progress in terms of our framework for power generation. And what we are saying to the world is that, don't worry, put all the power plants here and we'll transmit it to every country in the sub-region. And this is the long-term strategic leadership that is being provided, not only for our security and job creation, but for the sub-region. And we are with this effort.
So we're going to be exporting power when all of these things happen?
Well, if we are self-sufficient. Mm-hmm. And then what we are trying to do here is to make sure we are self-sufficient. Think right. We are not only thinking up, even though we are having all this gas coming, we've already started working on a gas master plan. And that gas master plan basically will lay out the supply projections we have, the demand projections, and look at the infrastructure that will be required in the future, and look at the cost of doing this, and the incentives to basically produce gas, and make sure we set our own national priorities. What is important for us as a country using gas? Is it fertilizer? Then how are we going to get enough gas for it? And so we are working on a master plan. I'm happy that we have almost finished, and it's going to go to cabinet for approval and moving forward. Mm. And so there's a lot we
are doing. I want to ask you where these gas plants are going to come from, all of these gas plants you're talking about. But let me just announce to viewers, if you have just joined us, of course, you can recognize the Honorable Ama Kofi Buah. You're listening to him right now. He's talking about yesterday's event. He's justifying why President Mahama said the inauguration of the gas plant is a game changer for our energy sector and generally for our economy. So you can send your emails to us on goodeveningghana@gmail.com. And as always, we will read the emails after the second break. goodeveningghana@gmail.com. Who is bringing these power plants that you're talking about?
Well, you were talking about the gas projects.
Yes.
That was what you were talking about first.
No, the thermal.
Well, the thermal. Who
are, you said they're going to locate, and you're talking about developing business in that area. Who are bringing it? Is it private people? Is it government?
IPPs.
Organized?
Going
what is IPP?
Independent power producers. Mm-hmm. You see, the reality is this. If your demand is growing as fast as ours is growing, mm-hmm. almost close to over 12% or more, and it's going to get to 20% annually, mm-hmm. which is roughly adding almost 250 megawatts every year. Obviously, government cannot continue to do that. We need to create an environment, an atmosphere that attracts this private sector. And we believe that the steps we are taking are going to attract this. And they've already started coming.
But there's one critical factor. You talked about the cost, that light crude is more expensive than gas. So you are pointing our minds to the fact that electricity may become cheaper in Ghana.
Yes.
But if it's going to be produced by independent private sector sort of people, they are profit oriented, and if they are going to take the gas from you and then sell it to the Ghanaian people, what is the guarantee that eventually electricity will be cheaper in Ghana?
Well, I think the bottom line is this: once you have indigenous gas, think about this, mm-hmm. it is half the price of importing light crude oil. Mm-hmm. And we are saying that with this Jubilee gas that is coming, mm-hmm. with the 10 gas that is coming, with the ENI gas reserve of almost 1 trillion mm-hmm. cubic feet of gas, with the Jubilee fulfilled. Remember Jubilee? Mm-hmm. We discovered Jubilee and we started. We are going to basically now develop it broadly to make sure that all the other discoveries around it, the mahogany teak, MTA, we call it the MTA.
These are all oil discoveries you're telling us.
These are all things we've already discovered mm-hmm. that are in place mm-hmm. that we are going to bring. Mm-hmm. And so we believe that all of these projects are not something we are dreaming about. They are full swing. We are working daily. And so in the coming years, on a yearly basis, we have projects that are on stream that are going to bring more gas. And we are saying that these are constraints that were preventing IPPs from coming, including making sure that we have set the tariffs right. But as we do all of these things, then these constraints are going to go away and we are going to attract these independent power producers. We are keeping one eye open because we are also going to make sure that we strengthen VRA to continue as a government institution to also bring more thermal plants. It's a balancing out here. But what is critical is that we look at our circumstance and we look at our neighbors and we say, what are we doing to address what I just said earlier? If we know that it is no longer hydro, that in the next decade, 80% of electricity in Ghana will come from thermal, mm-hmm. and thermal's ingredient, the critical ingredient is gas, and we are doing something about it indigenously. And we started that by inaugurating the major plant. Remember, government made that decision that we are not going to allow any private person to do it. We are going to do it ourselves and lay the foundation.
So this is a government-owned project?
This is a government-owned project. But the strategy was always, when we start it, and it is real, then the world will come. You will see that we are not going to stop there. We are also going to look at LNG. Because even with all the 5 trillion cubic feet of gas reserves that I've talked about, our generation is going so fast that we have to start thinking ahead beyond the indigenous gas, importing gas from long distances. Basically, that is what the LNG comes in.
I would like to talk about how this gas gets to Tema, for instance.
Yes, but, we'll talk about it.
So the whole story is that gas is going to be available in Ghana indigenously. We have put in structures to receive it.
It's not only gas, but mm-hmm. think about this. One of the reasons for this big celebration of this plant, mm-hmm. you remember the LPG, the gas lines across the country?
Yes.
This plant, we started in April 1st. It's not too long ago. But as soon as it started, the LPG lines are gone.
Ask me why. LPG lines are gone.
The gas lines that you see people carrying their gas lines, lengthy lines, they are gone because...
Oh, the queues that the queues, people go yeah, and the buy queues. LPG. Yes, yes, yes. They've not been around for a while.
The Atuabo plant already mm-hmm. is supplying, it's basically close to supplying half of the country's LPG.
The LPG demand.
Which is...
is being met.
Yes.
Okay.
The country's annual demand is about 360,000 metric
tons. LPG, the one we used to cook.
Yes, we used to cook. Mm-hmm. This plant, mm-hmm. the lean gas is for electricity. Mm-hmm. One of the byproducts is mm-hmm. the liquefied petroleum gas. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you that already it is producing close to 180,000 metric tons, which is basically 50% of our domestic requirement. And that plant, this plant we celebrate, mm-hmm. is supplying Western, Central, and Ashanti region already.
With LPG.
Already. So it is freeing up all the imports that we now have for Accra and its environment, environs. And mm-hmm. so you see all of a sudden, the lines
but
are
in
gone.
Future, would we get to the point where we don't import LPG anymore?
I think we're going to get there. We're going to get into a future.
And therefore it become cheaper?
This is the leadership that President Mahama has been talking about. He's putting in long-term solutions that the people of Ghana are going to feel. You remember, I went to a village, and all of a sudden you have all these gas stations, and we are giving free cylinders to rural communities because we already see that the gas or the LPG will have to go to all these low access areas. And the lady asked me a simple question. You mean that the gas from my own backyard is what I'm using to cook? I said, thank God it is true. And that is the excitement.
I see. So the story then is there's going to be electricity. That electricity is good. There's going to be gas that will produce electricity. So Ghana would have sufficient electricity, including even exporting electricity. Yes. Okay, so electricity...
Don't let us get too excited.
Yes, but the availability of electricity...
I've already said it's not going to be enough because the growth is going. So
okay,
we have had enough. We can't go to bed again. Remember, I've said that. We went to bed. We are not going to bed again with the leadership being...
So once we have electricity, it means that we have to translate that access to electricity to job creation.
That is
correct. You saying, therefore, that we can go to any part of the world and go to a Japanese company, say Toyota, and say that, can you come and set up a plant in Ghana and assure them that the lights will not go off?
That is what we are moving for. Think about it. Don't even... The Toyota is too far away. We are working to get to a point where we can go and revive the Vaco dream of Osagyefo. And the reason why that plant that can easily employ 5,000 young people who are so frustrated looking for jobs is because of electricity. Just imagine, take a trip to Tema and look at Vaco. It is lying there, ready to give people hope, and it's waiting for electricity. And this is the steps.
So as we are preparing for this, how are we preparing our youth? What is happening in the universities? Are you setting up faculties? Are they studying these things so that they can be useful for the project?
When we discovered oil, I think we made certain fundamental decisions. We said, this discovery must be a blessing and not a curse. And it shouldn't be just words. What are the steps, the very important steps we've taken? And I'm very proud that I've been in the ministry long enough to really know the history and the progress we've made. We talked about empowering Ghanaians to be in the forefront of the oil industry, not by words, but by actions. And what did we do about it? We said that the revenue from oil must be protected. And what did we do about it? The first thing we did was that we made sure that we passed what no African country did, the Petroleum Revenue Management Act that protects revenue from oil and puts the people of Ghana in charge of his accountability. And that's why you see the Public Accountability Committee. We then move on to talk about the issue of local content. And I'm very proud of that we have led that effort, supported by President Mahama, passed LI 2204, that basically has said that Ghanaians are the first priority in the industry. That everything in the oil industry must be done by Ghanaians if they can. Goods and services must be done by Ghanaians fundamentally. The only reason why...
Is that being done?
Well...
Are there Ghanaian companies that you have...
This is the record.
Giving contracts
this to? Is the record. But for the ally, you won't even hear what I'm about to tell you. Just in the last 1 year, if you look at the local Ghanaians that have registered with the Petroleum Commission, almost 300 new companies...
Ready to provide service.
Ready to provide service. Just in the last 1 year, over half a billion of new contracts have gone to Ghanaians.
Well, that's interesting.
That is big.
Half a billion dollars.
US dollars.
Oh, that's interesting.
In fact,
gone to Ghanaian companies.
I put it at 900, almost a billion.
Is it real Ghanaian companies or proxy Ghanaian with Chinese behind it?
The airline has serious penalties for anybody who tries to front. And so we are working to make sure that Ghanaians are in the forefront.
I see.
But we don't stop there. We are also working to build capacity with our key institutions that are supposed to be policemen, watch the industry, and make sure people don't cheat Ghana. And that is why we have established, we brought something called the oil and gas capacity, making sure the Environmental Protection Agency in charge of the environment can visit the FPSO. We provided ships. We'll be showing a documentary where we bring, working with the Petroleum Commission, basically, which is the policeman of the industry, to put in systems to make sure that indeed we are giving meaning to it. But we don't stop there. We are building the capacity of the universities, polytechnics, and technical institutions to produce the engineers who will come out to lead. And those are the fundamental things we are doing in the industry. And we are very proud of what is happening.
Before I take a break, let's do some of the politics that occur, some of the negatives about this project.
Yes, yes.
The daughter of the first president, Kwame Nkrumah, Samia Ayaba Nkrumah, was member of parliament for Jomoro.
Yes.
And she bitterly complains, she still does complain, that you, Honorable Kofi Buah, took the project from her constituency and deposited it in your constituency because you wanted political clout in the NDC. What happened? Why did you treat Samia so bad?
It was very, very interesting. You know, I think the history of the project when it comes to be written, all of these stories will come in. In any event,
what happened?
I am from her constituency because that's where my father is from. I'm from Jomoro.
Oh,
but an interesting history about the project and everything that happened in terms of where the project should be located was purely based on technical reasons. Originally, the survey was done. They said the project should be in Atuabo.
Atuabo where it is
Atuabo
now.
Atuabo where it is now. Another company did a feasibility study. They said the project should go to the Domol area, which is in the Jomoro district. Well, it so happened that's where my father is from. So when we came and the project was moved from Atuabo to the Domoli, I couldn't go to Atuabo because the guys were going to stone me to death. Then somehow Sinopec came and did a...
Who is Sinopec?
Sinopec is the current contractors who did the project.
Okay.
They came and said, no, the project should be here. Flat ground, technically, the terrain is the right. If we want the project to be delivered in the time period, and it's a huge document justifying why that project... And in fact, when I saw that first report, I remember as a deputy minister, I said, oh my God, I'm dead. The project is now going to move this way. And now the people, they are not happy. But the truth is that yesterday when you saw the celebration, it was very clear that all those communities now understand clearly that this project is not a project for one district. This is a huge project that has ever happened for one region in the whole Western region. And I talked about a project that is benefiting six districts: Jomoro, Evaluadura, Mpohowasa, Ahanta, Sekenita Krade, 60 communities through.
And the photograph that we are seeing, who is right to the right of President Mahama? Who is
this
that?
Is the Omahiri of the Eastern Nzima tradition.
To the right of President Mahama is a lady.
To the right of President Mahama is the Chinese ambassador.
Or the Chinese ambassador in Ghana.
She graciously was there, supporting, if you remember, the role the Chinese played in making sure the CDB facility was given.
And who are the chiefs in there?
Basically, the Western Region House of Chiefs.
Oh, I see.
Everybody was there. And the reason they were there was because, look, the storage facilities now, as was announced by the president, is going to be in the Jomoro district.
Oh, I see.
The project has metering stations all the way through...
So this is a project that's going to benefit Ghana by really changing the Western region.
It is changing
and creating the third capital for Ghana.
But it doesn't stop there. The same Western region is getting this over $6 billion project being delivered by, which is bigger than this project, by ENI.
And that when will that become?
That project is already started. Drilling, the ship is already there. Drilling is already started and we are working.
And that's gas only.
The FPSO, we've started building it. And so we are warming up to it. So we'll bring one FPSO and another one follows. And so it's an exciting time for Ghana.
You sound very excited.
I'll
come after the break to the issues about the company, the Ghana Gas Company.
Yes.
Its relationships with the GNPC.
Yes.
Because a few months ago, the news was awash with something you were trying to do, remove Dr. Botre, etc., etc.
Oh, no.
We'll try and understand what happened in that regard and where we are at this stage. But your emails will be read now. Send more coming. goodeveningghana@gmail.com. After the break, I'll continue with the Honorable Minister. So I'll be asking him at the end, actually, with all of these things happening, is the Western Region a no-go for the MPP? Is that his view about the matter? We'll be right back. Okay, so as usual, we are off to the emails right now, and let's see what we got. Felix Akoto says, Honorable, you and the NDC government are future thinkers. God bless you. That's the first one. JC says that none of the policies in Emmanuel Kofi Buah has transformed the Petroleum and Energy Ministry. Talk is cheap. JC is in Manprobi. The next one says, I would like to know how long it will take for all what the Honorable is saying they are going to do to sort out the nation's power issues to be completed. That's from Galilea. This one is from Osi. He says, good evening. Please ask Honorable Minister the following questions. One, what do we get from neighboring countries in return for the power supply? I'm sure we are selling it, but the minister will respond to that. Whether the introduction of the thermal power project will completely put an end to the hydro power generation across Omboda is a good question. Number three is, how sustainable is a thermal power project, given that the gas as a natural resource is exhaustible over time? Beautiful questions, Osi. We'll ask the minister that. Ishmael says, please let the minister give the history behind the gas project, because I know the project and its environmental impact. As environmental impact assessment was started by President Kufuor, he should be truthful to Ghanaians. He's already said that. The minister already said that. We, the people of Elembele and Ghana at large, thank God for the leadership of Honorable Ama Kofi Buah and His Excellency President Mahama. We know Ghana is transforming and shall prosper under your leadership. God bless you, Honorable Buah. That's from Elembele, Kuju. Another one is, Minister, in Ghana, we have poor maintenance culture of government institutions. What measures are we going to put in place so that in the next 10 to 20 years, this wonderful project does not go to waste? What are our future plans? Good question. Another one says that, good delivery, Honorable Kofi Buah. You are truly the right man for the job. God bless you. Then Ruben says, is the gas a finite resource? If it is, how long do we project to extract this resource? What do we do with the infrastructure when we exhaust the gas? Congrats, Minister. You're a real politician. Another one says, my question to Honorable Minister is, when exactly the ship will arrive in Ghana? Okay, that's Gideon Botre. The concert lecture from the minister is a total waste. Oh, no, that's Joe Nyan. That's not a good way to contribute to this program. And I'm very sorry to cancel out your email. That we don't do that on this program. You can have an opinion. You can have a question. You put it politely and respectfully. Thank you. Okay, so another one says, I myself have been to Atuabo since February this year. And I can tell you the gas Ghanaians are so excited. They just commissioned, had started, is solid, he says. Can you ask the minister where all those money went to? I don't know what he means by money. All those contracts he's talking about, ask him who are the companies undertaking those contracts. Those contracts are all in their names in disguise. Paul, tell them they can blah, blah, blah. Okay, so he's alleging corruption, that the contractors who are doing the project are fronting for some people. Ghana knows, let's see. Whilst the global north is fiercely riding its dependence on crude oil, the global south, including Ghana, is celebrating its pittance oil reserves and findings. No, we're not. We are talking about gas, William Opari, not oil, actually. This one says, Minister, in Ghana, we have poor maintenance culture. We already read that, so we'll get back to it. Is there any other one? Otherwise, we go. We have good enough emails for the minister to respond to. Good job by Honorable JEA Mills and Honorable JDM. Honorable is just excited, but Doomso is not over, I think he wants to say. And so that's the emails for today. I totally regret that email that I had to cancel. I'm sorry about that. Honorable Minister, so that's what people are saying.
Yes, but before
yeah.
You came here, remember before we left, you had said, talked about Dr. Boche. Let me be clear.
This is the GMPC and the Ghana gas situation.
The ultimate respect for Dr. Kwesi Buah is very accomplished. Mm-hmm. We're very proud of his service to the country. We have an excellent relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that we are in agreement. He was the chairman of the Gas Task Force.
Sorry.
He's been excellent and working very hard, working with the Ghana Gas team led by Dr. Sipanyanki and the employees. I'm very proud of that work. I think the issue was, how do we make sure that the aggregator of gas, which is GMPC, who is selling the gas to Ghana Gas, are aligned in a way that brings value to the people of Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the discussion, and that is the view. And I believe that going forward, we as a country and working as a government led by President Mahama, what we are doing is to make sure that these government institutions work in a way that creates serious value and efficiency for the people of Ghana. And that's exactly what we are going to do. And so we there's no problem at all. But I think I like the emails. I think that there was a question about the cost of the project.
The cost of the project,
now,
yes.
This project is very international in nature. You remember, we have almost 8 big international companies that really come from all over the world. Sinopec is from China. We have the other companies from the U.S. We have some from Europe. And so many other companies. And two, but we were specific about the value of the project. I know, for example, that the pipeline, the offshore pipeline, was projected to be about $200 million. Mm-hmm. I know that the gas processing plant itself was about $250 million. I know that the 111-kilometer 12-inch pipeline was about $300 million, around there. And then there was about $100 million for other ancillary services, like the helicopters and others for the security of the pipelines and others. So those we know. And I believe that we that have the opportunity to serve the people of Ghana are serving mindful that we are holding the public trust and we are going to be accountable on a daily basis.
So you are responding to the question where he's alleging that what you are saying is that this project is an international project.
That is correct.
Participated in by high-profile and reputable companies.
Yeah.
And they are not companies who people are going to front for and that kind of thing.
No way. Mm. But obviously, there's a lot we did. For example, if you recall, when we got to a point in the project, and thanks to the leadership of His Excellency President Mills, we had to set up a gas task force to coordinate activities of so many agencies, remember, and that is the magnitude of this project.
A gas task force.
The national gas.
Which institutions comprised or composited?
So many of them. We had to bring the Environmental Protection Agency, the Ghana Standard Board, the Petroleum Commission, the Energy Commission, Tema Oil Refinery, Ghana Gas itself, the Ministry of Power and Petroleum, obviously, and Volta River Authority, because we needed to align with them. The upstream producers, which Tello is the operator. We needed to work with them to make sure that the tie-in is aligned and the tie-in.
So this task force has been meeting for 6 years?
We have worked and coordinated the Ministry of Roads and Highway, making sure that the bridges and the roads that would transport the LPG, it was a huge, and I think that on a day like this, we look back and talk about those well-coordinated efforts, day and night, that has brought us this far. And I think that is important. We cannot underestimate that.
That's interesting. Yesterday, the president was concerned about a port.
Yes.
A Lonro port. And he was even almost angry.
That is
about
true.
A delay of some construction. But what is it about?
You know, if you really think about the Gulf of Guinea, and if somebody wants to understand the vision of President Mahama, he should look at why this port is important to him. The Gulf of Guinea, almost every country along the coast has discovered oil. Which country will strategically lead the oil industry? The country that will lead that oil industry is the country that will strategically have an oil and gas dedicated port that will make sure that all the equipment, materials needed for oil production in the sub-region, they have it. As we speak, if you want pipes right now, you have to go to Brazil or go to maybe Angola. Who is going to do it? We are in competition with Cote d'Ivoire and others. Cabinet has approved that this port dedicated.
What is the port going to do? It's going to produce pipes?
The port is basically going to be a big workshop where ships that are sailing around will come and refill, repairs, where materials will be stored. So on a moment's notice.
Dedicated to petroleum?
Petroleum industry.
I see. That's interesting.
Bunkering will be done there.
So it's like a one-stop shop. If you come there, you can get everything.
Helicopter services, everything. And we are saying that if we are not quick in doing this, other countries will do this. And guess what? The same members of parliament who were part of the debate, who helped approve this long report, now get out of parliament as if they were not there and went to put an injunction saying that this must be stopped. And the argument was that it's only Ghana ports and harbors who can build port. In fact, the Attorney General has discounted that. They've gone to the court, it's been thrown away. And 12 members of parliament, as the project, just last week, the financiers were here for financial due diligence ready. And I got a chance to meet them to give them the assurance. And some of these things are intended to...
So the point you're making is that parliamentarians are in court against this court. Project.
And frankly, these parliamentarians...
What is the case they're making that it should be done by Ghana Port?
Let me put my political cap here. Mm-hmm. These parliamentarians are all MPP parliamentarians. And all of them, quite frankly, are not even from the Western region. And what are they telling us? That 5,000 jobs cannot be created in the Western region? Well, I guess I'm sorry. But that is why...
But we're under the rule of law, Minister. We're under the rule of law, isn't
it? The court says there's no basis for it.
So why are you not going on?
And then the court has decided on the matter. You go and bring the same matter. But this is not a matter that is for me. Mm-hmm. I think it's a matter for the people of Ghana to decide. And it will be decided. One government, one political party is so focused on creating 5,000 jobs. Another one said they don't deserve it in the Western region. I think my people understand
that's
that.
Too political, Honorable
Minister. Well, it's true.
It's too political.
I'm talking about facts.
You're putting a political spin. You're putting a political spin on this.
I try not to do that. But in this very case, I don't understand. And I think maybe I'm saying that so the political bosses...
But the court process will be exhausted by the time they get Supreme Court.
So I'm saying that so that the political bosses have to understand that there will be a price to pay if they don't understand that this port is important.
A political price to pay?
I believe that.
A loss of votes. You mean
well,
a loss of votes?
I think I've said mine.
The emails kept bringing up something. The finite nature of the gas resource. So you've built a beautiful infrastructure. The gas is not infinite. It will finish at some
point. That is correct.
When it does, what happens?
I think it's a very good question. Mm-hmm. This gas and all the gas I've talked about reserves of about 5 trillion. Mm-hmm. It will last maybe 25 years. Mm-hmm. What do we do? What are we planning to make sure? Are we sitting down and just hoping that after 25 years, what happens? Mm-hmm. I think we have to be proactive. We have to continue developing. And that is why we are keeping our industry very active. With a lot of, as we speak, we are aggressively working on the Voltaire Basin. Remember, 40% of our landmark is the Voltaire Basin. Mm-hmm. It is unexplored. We believe we have serious potential.
So what are we going to do there? Look for gas there as well?
We are looking for oil and gas, and we believe we have a huge potential there. But we don't stop there. I know for a fact that there's a serious focus. We wanted to make sure the other source of power is...
Hydro?
No, not hydro.
Thermal, crude?
No, hydro. Coal plant.
Coal, yeah.
And I have to be frank that I know that that discussion is also ongoing because the reality is that our energy security cannot be compromised. And the leadership being provided by President Mahama is looking at all these options. Mm. And he's not only looking at these options, he's also looking at the institutional structures that will make them happen. And that is why I talked about the gas master plan that the Ministry of Petroleum has worked on already. Mm. Working with stakeholders, we are sending it. And that gas master plan will really lead the way. Mm. And give impetus for us to bring all these dreams into reality. Mm.
Okay. The other question, which is not directly related, somebody was talking about Doomsday is not over. We know that you began the process of the power badges. Is it a good story coming? The power badges.
Well, I think that I know that the Ministry of Power is working very hard on this matters. Mm. And they are very committed to it. And the reason why I'm very confident about it, we are working with GMPC, working with them to make sure that the fuel aspect is provided. Mm. And day and night, these car power, Mary, and other projects are on stream, and we are very confident that it will happen. Mm.
That's interesting. One more question. Deregulation.
Yes.
It's happened under you. So quite a few things have happened under you. Local content bill has been passed.
It's happened under the leadership has happened. Of President John Dramani
Yes,
Mahama.
Deregulation is happening now.
Think about this.
So you said the queues of LPG is gone. We have not seen petroleum queues for a while. Is that something that's come to stay?
Well, it's exciting. Mm.
And we'll have time to talk about deregulation in full in this program.
Basically, what we have done is basically saying that there are things that government can do. But there are some practical things that government must focus on. In this deregulated environment, we are still focused on helping the fishermen in premise, marine gas oil, in other areas. We are holding them. But we are basically saying, with a strong regulatory environment, just going to buy petroleum products and selling should be a business for the ordinary Ghanaian businessman.
Anybody can
And do it. With a proper regulation, I think that is what is going to happen. And we are moving quickly in that
We have area. To wrap it up. Let's talk about what's happening in Lembele. Did you pick your forms and submit them?
I picked my form with fanfare and excitement. The people of Lembele are excited. We brought so much hope. And the people of Lembele are urging me on that first time you bring mobile clinic that has treated more people probably than clinics in the district. Second time, you have an elderly care center that is probably the biggest in the country that will take care of the elderly. Creative ideas to empower the youth. Continue doing that good.
So they're going to give you a third term.
I believe so. I'm excited about working so hard for the people of Lembele.
Is it nice to be a petroleum minister, Honorable Kofi Buah? You seem to be very happy. Is it nice to be a petroleum minister?
Well, I've been in the ministry for almost 7 years, and I think that.
And you're enjoying it.
Well, I've learned to take blows, and I think I am very happy waking up every day and working hard for the people of Ghana.
Thank you, sir. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
And I think you're doing a good job. God bless you. That was Good Evening Ghana with Honorable Kofi Buah. Thanks for watching. Good night.